So I'm very happy to be back at BIA once again. I greatly appreciate the work that is done here, and I feel this is a very rich and fertile center for Dhamma, a great resource for people here in Bangkok. Speaking in English is much preferable to me than trying to speak in Thai, as my Thai language is very mediocre, minimal. So this evening, the theme of the Dhamma talk is life without Sīla is like a car without brakes. And so when the BIA contacted me and spoke about the theme for the year, Sīla Dhamma, please come back. That was a title that came into my mind as it was a title that was given to a talk of mine I gave many years ago when I was living in San Francisco. And San Francisco is very different from Bangkok in that Bangkok is very flat. San Francisco has 42 hills, so it's very steep. And so trying to drive a car in San Francisco with no brakes is very obviously a bad idea. But even here, as you anyone who's been in a car, a van here in Bangkok, you know, even if you don't have hills, you need to start and you need to stop, especially in a traffic jam, Lot Dit, you know. If you haven't got brakes, then you run into the back of the car in front very easily. You can't stop at the junctions. You can't slow down for the turns. And so it's just as applicable a metaphor here in Bangkok as everywhere else. We might think, well, I want to go places, and so I just need the accelerator on the car. I just want to go ahead. I don't want to slow down. I don't want to stop. I just want to go straight to Nibbana. Right? I don't want to be obstructed. I don't want anything to be in my way. And in the West, or maybe also here in Thailand, people very much like the idea of freedom. We look for freedom, a lack of restrictions. And we think that the rules, the laws, the gotmai, the taxes, everything is getting in my way. All these people, you know, when we're on the road, they are the Lot Dit. How many of you think I am Lot Dit? I am part of the traffic jam. And not many of us think that way, right? They, the others, they are the traffic. I am going somewhere. They are the traffic that's in my way. Jamai? That's how we think. But it's more skillful to understand, and the theme of this talk is that we are traffic too. We are sharing the road. So when we think about freedom, we think, well, I want to be free. I want to be able to follow any desire I have. I want to be able to do whatever I like. I don't want people to get in my way. I want to have all my wishes fulfilled all the time, and then I would be free. This is how we think when our ideas are based on dhanha, on desire, but we don't understand that freedom is not in fulfilling every desire that we have, but rather freedom comes through understanding desire, understanding dhanha, craving. And when we understand how dhanha, how craving works, then we can really be free. that gives us the key, the kunjaya, to get out of the prison. In the West, as I said, I was living in California for a long time, and the ideal of freedom is very strong there. And particularly around religion or spirituality, people, maybe they grew up in the Christian religion, a Catholic religion or Jewish religion, many, many rules, lots of sikapot, lots of do this, don't do that. Yeah. And they want to be free. So they think, I want to be free, I want to have pure spirituality with no rules. Nice idea. I don't want anything to restrict me, to be holding me back. that maybe they have a genuine feeling of the truth, the ultimate reality is pure, is ever present. The Dhamma is always here. Or maybe if they think in the language of God and theistic religion, they say God is ever present. You know, the truth is here and now. Why do we need rules? Why do we need restrictions? Why do we need structure? Why do we need a system? Why do we need religion? We can just be free. So in California, particularly in the 1960s, 1970s, and into the 80s, these were very strong ideas. Maybe some of them, these ideas came here to Thailand as well. That they think, why do we have all these rules, these customs, these titles? Who needs that? And very much the spirit of Ajahn Buddhadāsa, he was trying to cut away many of the old useless things that have gathered around the religion. So when people think, why do we need any kind of structure at all? The Dhamma is here and now, wake up! And then they try to live without any kind of rules or any kind of restrictions whatsoever. And Buddhadāsa, Ajahn Chah, they used to speak on this kind of theme a lot, and they say, yes, on the ultimate level, on the level of Satchatam, and on the level of ultimate reality, Paramatta Satcha, yes, that's true. But we don't just live on the level of Paramatta Satcha, we also live with the Samuti Satcha. We don't just live in the world of the timeless Dhamma, we also live in the world of Dhamma of time and the body and people. And in one of Lumpo Cha's Dhamma talks, he was speaking about this theme. He said, ultimately, yes, the precepts, the Sīla, is just Kong Samut, it's just a conventional truth. It's just a samuti satcha. It's just an ordinary, conventional reality. And we can say the only thing that really matters is the paramatta satcha, the pure Dhamma. Yes, that's true. But if we cling to that idea, then we find ourselves in conflict with other people, with the world, with other people, because and we find ourselves in a state of wrongness, we're out of balance. And he said, why is it wrong? He said, it's wrong because of people. It's wrong because of people's attachment. So when I follow my desire or I do what I want, I try to live from a place of high Dhamma. Still, I have to live with the other people on the road. I can say, there is no left, there is no right. We don't need to be attached to form. I can drive wherever I want to on the road, but then the Dhamma, the policeman pulls you over and says, no, you can't. In this country, you drive on the left. And so that we are, when we attach to the idea of the ultimate, we are, missing or ignoring the other part of our reality. When the Buddha was enlightened under the Bodhi tree, he was, awakened to the Dhamma. He understood the Dhamma, and in his heart, he was completely free. At that time, according to the stories, the forces of Man, there's still the army, were gathered around. And so the Buddha was already enlightened, Trotsarulao, he was already liberated, but Mara would not retreat. And Mara said, who do you think you are? You gave up on your wife and family, you walked out, you failed in your duty as a prince, and you gave up on that. Then you became a yogi, and you couldn't succeed as a yogi, and you gave up on your ascetic practice, your say, living in a state of hardship and fasting, you gave up on that, you couldn't even be a proper yogi, and then you come up with this idea of the middle way, just so that you can have some food to eat. So, what kind of a joke is this? You know, now you're trying to pretend that you're fully enlightened. You know, who do you think you are? You have no right to claim to be enlightened. You can't claim to sit on the Vajra Asana, on the seat of enlightenment. He says, I'm the one who should claim the Vajra seat. I'm the king of the universe. Isn't that true? And then he called on his army of the demons and soldiers and yakas and said, isn't that true? And they said, yes, Lord, you are indeed the ruler of the universe. He said, see, that these are my witness. Who do you have as your witness? And so then the Buddha reached down and he touched the earth. And then he called Mayatarani, and then she came forth. And then she said, Mara, this is my true son. And he has the sole right to claim leadership over all beings in the universe. And you, Mara, are defeated. And then she unwrapped her hair, and then the flood of water washed away the armies of Mara. Then they came back, Kaukama, asking for forgiveness. So to me, this is a very important symbol about enlightenment and liberation and about living in the world, and why life without Sīla is like a car without brakes. Because we might have that insight of like, yes, the Dhamma is here and now, the Dhamma has no form. Nibbana is not big or small, it's not female or male, it's not long or short, it's not purple or white or yellow or green or red. Nibbana has no form, no color, no shape. Nibbana is here and now, just wake up. We might have that insight inside, but as long as that insight is not connected to the earth, then Mara does not retreat. Kajamai, you understand? But then it's when the Buddha reached out and called on the Earth Mother, so he had to be humble. He had to, if he just said to Mara, I'm totally enlightened, and you just have to admit it, just because of his insight, his panya inside himself, that wasn't enough. He had to call on the Earth Mother to be his witness. He had to touch the earth. So to me, that's a very important symbol. It's like saying, yes, the Dhamma is here and now. Yes, the rules and laws and structures, these are just conventions. They're just kong samut, conventional truth. They're just invented, or they're just mostly agreements made by people. They have no real essence. They are all empty. But this is part of what we live with. And if we disrespect that, we're not really free. But when the Buddha touched the earth, he said, yes, there is the Dhamma which is timeless, which is unborn, undying, which is infinite, which is pure, but there is also earth, water, fire, and wind. There is this body which was born from parents back in Kapilavatthu. It needs to breathe. It needs to eat. It has a relationship to all other beings in the world. So there's a humility of recognizing, yes, there is the vijja, there is the wisdom, the knowledge, but there's also the material world, the charana. And when we talk about the qualities of the Buddha, we say, vijja charana sampanno. Chamai? Vijja charana sampanno. So if it's just the vijja, then that's only half the picture. We can say the only thing that matters is the pure Dhamma. Just wake up, everything is understood. That's true. But if that vichara is not connected to charana, is not connected to our conduct, then the Buddha under the Bodhi tree, the forces of Mara will not back off. They will not leave us alone. But it's only when we say, yes, there is this paramatta satya, the ultimate truth, but there's also the samuti satya. There's also the other traffic on the road. There's the other people. There's we might be fully awake and understanding. I might know that this is just sankhara tang lai, just sankharas arising and passing away. We say, hey, I'm not a sankhara. You know, I'm your sister. I'm a woman, or I'm a man, or I'm the host of this event. You know, or I am a monk. I'm a layperson. You know, that's what I am. And if we don't recognize or acknowledge, don't respect that other people see the world in different ways, then we will always have conflict. So this is how the Buddha defeated Mara, was through being humble and saying, yes, there is the ultimate truth, but yes, there is also the ordinary worldly truth. There is this body, this life, this mind, this personality. So this, I feel, is a very important story to reflect on, that vichar is important, but if we cling to vichar on its own, we say, well, you know, everything's impermanent, it's all empty, you know, just let go. If you say that to the policeman on the road, he says, my why? No, you still get a ticket. You're still, yeah, the fine is empty too, you know, give me the money. Kajai mai? So that the world sees things in a different way. So when we are considering our life and how to live, how to be free, it's very important to understand that things like the rules of the road, the other people that we share the road with, the people in our family, the people that we work with, that we are when we are able to not just look at life from our own perspective, but from the perspective of others as well, then we will be able to live peacefully. We will have a true quality of freedom. If I only follow my own perspective, my own point of view, and I ignore what other people think, how other people act, then that's like driving without brakes. That's like ignoring the feelings of the people around you. And very quickly, you'll find yourself in trouble. You'll find a continuing state of conflict. So when we want to be free, we want to have a quality of, say, liberation in our life, then the basis of that is to let go of selfish thinking, to let go of the I, me, and mine. In Bali, we say ahankara, mamankara. If it's me first, I, me, and mine, then we will always find ourselves in conflict. Mara and the army will always be around. But it's when we are ready to let go of me and mine, and we are ready to be humble, to make way for others, then we will be able to find a quality of harmony. Yeah, just now, as our friend was introducing me, she said, I've been given this Chakun title. I was very happy, honored to receive that. And when I told my sisters that I had received this title, first I had to explain what Jiaokun meant, which is difficult. You don't have the same thing in England. Though they wanted to come over and to be present for the ceremony. So, yeah. But even though, you know, in Thailand, to be a senior monk or to be raised up to have a title like Chakun is very important. Still, and my sisters wanted to come for the ceremony, still, I am the little brother. So to them, first thing is, I'm not really a monk. Not really. Yeah, really, I'm their little brother. And he's kind of, he acts as a monk, but really, yeah, he's my baby brother. And if I say I'm not your baby brother, you know, I'm a Jiaokun, you know, then you have a problem. You have a conflict. So but that's how we operate in life, is that, you know, you should see me the way I want to be seen. I'm an important woman. You know, I'm a doctor. You should recognize that. Or I'm your mother. You know, you know, I'm your dad. Or I'm your boss. You know, you have to look at me like that. You know, then if we act in that way, then it's like driving a car without brakes. Yeah, that we're not being humble. We're not respecting the ways of the world, the views of the world. And as Lumpur Cha said, you know, why is it wrong to say that? Well, I am the boss. You know, I'm a senior monk. I'm a Chao Kun. Like, why is that wrong to think that way, to act that way? It's wrong because of people. And you can't say to someone, you should be different. Yeah, they say, why? Well, like Lumpur Cha would say, it's like going up to an oak tree and saying, you're not a beech tree. It's right, I'm an oak tree. You know? Or like in Thailand, you say, you're not a bamboo tree. You're not bamboo. You know, you're a maison. You're a pine tree. Like, yes, I'm a bamboo plant. That's why I look like this. I say, well, you shouldn't be like that. You should be like a pine tree. Why? So this is what we do with each other, right? You might think, well, it's crazy going up to a tree and saying, you should be a pine tree. It's crazy. It's like, well, why? Why should I be a pine tree? I'm bamboo. But that's what we do. Like, you know, you should see me in this way. You should get out of my way. Yeah, I don't want traffic. I've got a Dhamma talk to give. You know, you're in my way. Get out of the way. You know, you're clogging up the road. Like, but they don't think I'm traffic. Like none of you. You don't think I'm traffic. How many of us are on the road thinking, oh dear, I'm getting in the way of all these good people. They've got important places to go to. How unfortunate, I am in their way. I'm very sorry for being traffic on your road. We don't think like that, do we? But if we change our thinking and we say, well, how unfortunate, I'm filling up the road for all these good people who got important places to go, then at that moment, what is our heart like? Sabai. Sangop. So this is say using our own panya, our own wisdom. Now when we think about sila, often we think of that as being the precepts, the sinha, sinpa, the five precepts, the eight precepts, and we take the sila to mean the rules, rule number one, rule two, rule three, rule four, or five. But and so that is one aspect of sila. But that's like the external aspect of sila. And so I'd say that's the less important aspect of sila. The most important is the kunatam, the actual gunadhamma, the quality of sila itself. So the rules of a society are there to help us to live as good human beings. They're not there to inhibit your freedom. They're there to help us to live as wise and kind, unselfish and honest human beings. That's what they're for. So the precepts are the same. That it's not saying, don't do this, don't do that. Because the precepts are like an external form, but they're trying to touch our own heart, the gunatam, the good, wholesome qualities of our own heart. They're trying to remind us of what in our heart we see as being true and good and right. Can you follow that? So that most important thing, sila, is not the rules. Sila is the unselfish heart, is the heart that loves goodness. So when people take refuge in the Buddha Dhamma Sangha, at Amaravati, I always like to translate things into English and do a little explanation. Sometimes the Asian people are a bit surprised when I start to talk about what it means to take refuge, to the Tisarana. But just like Lumpur Buddhata, Lumpur Cha, they like to make these rituals meaningful to help people understand the essence, the value, the meaning behind these qualities. So to take refuge in Buddha is not just to respect Gautama Buddha, our teacher and the founder of this religion, the great enlightened master of 2,500 years ago, but as Lumpur Cha would often say, that the Buddha that is the real refuge is the puru, the quality of awareness in your own heart, the vicha, the knowing, awake, aware quality. So Buddha, Lumpur Cha would say, the Buddha who lived 2,500 years ago, he's gone. You know, there's no need to talk to him, he's gone. That's not the Buddha that is the most valuable refuge. The Buddha that is the refuge is your awareness, that quality of your own citta, your own jitjai, that right now is awake, that right now knows and understands. That's the sarana, because that's always available. That's not gone to parinibbana. That's here now. And you can use that. You can be awake. You can know right now. So that's why the puru that is the refuge is that capacity to be awake. And then pratham, the refuge in Dhamma, is not just relying on the teachings of the Buddha, or the words of the Buddha, or even the kind of the conceptual understanding, the ideas, the knowledge of the sutta, but the Dhamma which is the refuge is the Dhamma which is Kwam Tamachat, which is nature itself. The word Dhammachat in Thai comes from the Pali Dhammajati, born of the Dhamma. Right there in the word Tamachat, Dhammachati, born of the Dhamma. So when we take refuge in Dhamma, it means be realistic. It doesn't just mean I trust the words of the Buddha, but it means living in tune with reality, living in tune with nature. So that is this recognizing this body, this mind, this personality, it's part of nature. To let go of self-centered thinking and to see this body, this mind, how could it not be part of nature? That's what we are. Everything, every aspect of this body, this mind, is an aspect of Dhamma, of Dhamma is Dhammachati, is born of a Dhamma. So to take refuge in Dhamma means to let go of self-concern and to see that you are Dhamma, that everything about your body, your mind, is an aspect of Dhamma, of nature. When I speak about taking refuge in Sangha, then about Silatam that I like to speak. So to take refuge in Sangha is not just trusting the people who wear these jiwan and shave their head. That refuge in Sangha is not just to pay respects to the Ajahns or to follow the words of the elders, but to the internal aspect, just like with Buddha and Dhamma, is to listen to that voice in your heart that loves the good, that says, this is beautiful, this is kusan, is wholesome, kusala, that that is, say, that is inspired and finds beauty in the goodness of others. That is, to take refuge in Sangha is to listen to that voice that says, oh yes, that's wholesome, yes, that's noble, that is ariya, that is a beautiful way to speak, to act. And it's to take refuge in Sangha is to choose to listen to that voice and to follow that understanding of your own heart. So this is, if you like, when you take the refuge in Buddha Dhamma Sangha, and then that when we say take the Sīla, 5 precepts or 8 precepts, this is like checking your brakes. You know, when you go to the garage, you say, please check my brakes. So that's like going to the Wat and Kosin, you know, Rapsin Ha. It's like having your brakes checked, like having them tightened up, put the new brake fluid in, make sure the your brakes are working properly. That's like when you're taking the precepts, because the precepts, the Sinha, they are explaining, okay, if you want to listen to that in your citta, which loves the good, these are the areas to look out for. Kachai mai? These are the areas where we get lost. So this is what to look out for. If you want to listen to the good, this is the areas where we get deaf, where we don't hear so clearly. So when we look at the 5 precepts, what they are doing is they are helping us to see clearly the areas where we get caught. So the first one is about aggression, about disrespecting the life of other beings, that the feeling that my life is more important than yours, or that insect, or that animal, that fish, that my life is more important than you. So that aspect of aggression or violence is very natural to us. These are in psychology, they talk about the reptile brain, like the instincts of the brain. So the 5 precepts, particularly the first 4, are all about guarding the mind against the activity of the reptile brain, if that's not too complicated. Aggression is like that, the mind that attacks, that wants to hurt another, to kill another, or to eat another. So aggression is the first precept, kautinang. The second precept is about property, about owning, and wanting to possess things, or about territory. This is my place, you know, back off. This is, you can't come in, this is my place, I'm protecting this. Or I want your territory, I want your land, I'm going to take it. So these are about these natural instincts of the mind where it's easy to get lost. So about aggression, about property, then sexual desire, number 3, is the kautisam, is the in some of the suttas the Buddha said sexual desire, there's nothing more compelling, nothing more exciting to the mind of a man than the sight, sound, smell, taste, or touch of a woman. That's the first sutta in the Anguttara Nikaya. Second sutta is, there's nothing more compelling to a woman than the sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch of a man. So and if you're a man attracted to other men or a woman attracted to other women, same. It works either way. So the force of sexual desire, which is very, very immensely powerful in nature. The third precept is protecting us against the power of that. And then the fourth precept about speech, lying, is about the force of self, what we call self-advantage, looking for getting things for me. When we lie, when we tell tell things that are untrue, it's about getting extra for me, advantage, and getting more for myself. So it's about greed and about me, trying to get things or work things for myself. So then those first 4, these are all natural aspects of the mind. They're what we inherit from our ancestors. Many generations ago, the reptile, animal brain, about aggression, property, territory, sexual desire, self-advantage. So these are powerful forces. So the Buddha established the precepts to say, look, be very careful. This is a sharp turn. You really need your brakes. You know, slow down. It's a sharp turn. You know, the speed limit. So that the precepts are telling us to be careful, because this is where we really lose it. Then the fifth precept is very interesting, because the first four, the Buddha said, these are automatically negative karma. If you kill something, or you steal something, or you engage in sexual misconduct, or you lie, then that's automatic bad karma. Fifth, it's not automatic. Oh, that's interesting. But the fifth is always there, because if you don't follow the fifth precept, then the first four, they decay very quickly. Right? I think we all are aware of that. That's why we drink, is so we can not think about the first four precepts. We like to be unmindful so that we can follow those feelings more freely. So the rules are useful. I'm not saying, I said the gunatama, the actual quality of virtue, of loving the good, that's the most important thing. But the spelling out of the rules, it helps us to say, remember what we really love in our heart. It helps us to remember what we respect. It helps us to remember the qualities of the manusa, the living as a true human being, and not just living like an animal or like a hungry ghost, living like a demon or a yaka, but rather living like a true human being. So in our Buddhist psychology, we speak of what is called the lokapala, or that which protects the world. And these are qualities of sensitivity, that gunatamma, wholesome qualities of the heart that help us to keep on track, to help us to drive safely. So we call these hiri otapa, and these are hiri is that feeling of when you've told a lie, or you've taken advantage of someone, or you've killed something, that it's that, oh, when you remember that, it's that painful feeling in your heart. That's a good pain. Hiri is very useful. Like, physical pain helps us to protect the body. That keeps us from getting infected, and we look after the injury so we get better. Hiri is a psychological pain, so that then when we remember having hurt someone or told a lie or stolen something, then that painfulness is protecting our heart, just like the physical pain protects our body. Otapa, they say, is like the when you see somebody else acting in an unwholesome way, someone killing other people or stealing or cheating, that or someone hurting another, that you feel is painful to you, that is otapa, is that wanting to pull away from what is unwholesome in the world around. So these are, sometimes people feel, I wish I could just not have so, not remember or not have to think about all those horrible things I did. That's understandable. We don't want to create more stress or self-hatred. But it's important to recognize that when we use hiri otapa in a skillful way, it's not feeding our own negativity, it's not making ourselves self-critical, but it's helping us to see, oh, when I did that, it had a painful result, therefore, don't do it again. Otherwise, you'll feel that pain again. That's all. We don't need to create the atta, we don't need to create I and me and mine around that. And in that way, then hiri otapa is a real protector. It really helps us. Now, the point of having brakes on your car is not so that you'll stop and never go anywhere, right? The point of brakes is so that you can get where you want to go safely. And also you can help the others that you share the road with to get where they want to go in a safe way too. So this is the purpose of a gunatama, the wholesome qualities of the heart, that these are what help us all to get where we want to go. And the great potential of the life of a manusa, as a human being, that this this is the most fertile ground for enlightenment. Like I was just saying in the little interview, as a human being, we have an animal body. That's why we have the reptile brain. We have an animal body. It needs to eat. It has sexual desire. It has fear. It has aggression. It needs to breathe. We have a human body, an animal body, but we have the mind of a god, like a devata in great intelligence. We can be compassionate. We have the Brahmavihan. We have the mind of the Brahma gods. Compassion, metta, karuna, mudita, upeka. We have the mind of a god. So as a manusa, this is fantastic opportunity. You have an animal body, right? A tirachana loka. Animal body and the mind of a Brahm, of a Brahma god. This is perfect. So you can have the happiness of a god, of a deva, for a little bit, but then you get hungry, or you get afraid, or you get annoyed. So then you get the happiness of a god, but it can't last long. And then you have an animal body, and so you can experience the kind of pain and difficulty, the struggle of an animal world, but also it doesn't last long, and we have the panya to recognize this is just the fear and anger and desire of the animal world. It's not who and what we are. It's just part of the karma of our birth. We can let go. So this is why Buddhas are always born in the human world, because it's the perfect mixture, the limitation of the animal body. So you can definitely experience dukkha, kwamtuk. You can't escape. If you just live in the Brahma world, the Deva world, kwamtuk, suffering? Suffering? What suffering? Loom. Oh, it's just too pleasant all the time. And the animal world is too painful all the time. But as a human being, we have the painfulness of the animal world and the sublime, the pure attitudes of the Brahma world. And so it's a perfect mixture for waking up. So my encouragement is to have our brakes checked to make sure we can drive safely, and that is a great blessing for our own lives. We get where we want to go, and we help others to get where they want to go safely as well. And where we want to go, as we say in Buddhist tradition, is Nippon, to peacefulness, to true liberation. So I offer these thoughts for reflection this evening, and we can have some time for santanatham. I think there's a microphone to pass around, so if people have questions.
Okay, any question? Please put your hand up, I bring the microphone.
I have two questions. The first one, if we have a chance to talk to someone who have an idea of committed suicide, committed suicide, how can we talk to them? When we live with someone who have an idea of committed suicide, how do we approach them, or how do we talk to them?
That's a good question. Sometimes when people say, well, it's my life, I can do what I like with it. But I'd say our life is not our own. Yeah? My life is connected to the other members of my Sangha, to my family, to the world. And taking your own life is as much kāt sin as taking the life of another person. And so you don't want to just say that as a kind of threat, just to say, you know, you're a bad person or you'll be punished, but also to point out that taking a human life, whether it's your life or somebody else's, there's a lot of negative and destructive intention. The chetana is very destructive and cruel in order to carry that out. So you have to close your heart in order to kill something and to kill yourself. There's a shutting down of your own heart. So I've been around quite a number of people who wanted to commit suicide for different reasons, different times. And the most helpful thing is usually to ask them, well, what causes them to feel that way? How have they been trying to work with their mind? What's the cause of them feeling so hopeless or feeling like they're going to solve anything? Because it's just like if you, in a way, it's like if you drink to, you have a problem, you're in a conflict with someone, and you think, I'm just going to go out and get drunk. And while you're drinking, it's like a kind of psychological suicide. You just forget the whole thing, you just loom. And in France, they have the expression to that, you know, why do you drink wine? To forget, of course. And so when we're drunk, you can forget. But when you wake up the next morning, it's there again. And so to me, it's helpful for people when they say, I want to commit suicide, I want to end it all, to help them to see that's not going to end anything. And if they don't have a belief, or they say, no, when the body dies, that's it, there's no more consciousness, then it's you have to approach it in a bit of a different way. But the most helpful thing is to look at the causes of why they feel so hopeless and to try and find other ways forward. Say, well, can we look at solving the problem you have through a different way? And are there other possibilities, changing your attitude or changing your living situation, just to say, give them more possibilities? Because usually when someone wants to commit suicide, like, they see that there's no way forward. There's no possibility. And to help them to see, no, there's many possibilities, that you're just not seeing them. And it's going to be different for every person, every situation, so you have to say, be open to listen to them, and then to draw on your own panya to find what are those other ways forward. Okay, so another question.
Grab namaskar and khao 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 khao. It's an honor to have this opportunity to speak with you this evening. I'm a beginner. I'm beginning a study of Buddhism. I started studying the teachings of Luang Pu Cha about 2 to 3 years ago. And then more recently through visitations with Ajahn Jayasaro and Bak Chong, and then through your Amaravati podcasts. I had two questions today, but I think you covered most of the first question about atta and conventional wisdom and letting go and having sati to remind ourselves and to be humble and kind. My second question is, I will be ordained in January and become a monk for 1 month, and I was hoping that you could provide some advice or guidelines for those 4 to 5 weeks I'll be in a temple. Thank you.
Well, probably the best advice, two things. One is to try and have as few expectations as possible. Like, when I go to the Wat, then I will and I won't, and I hope it's like this and I hope it's not like that. Just as that arises, just say, well, my nair, you know. If you've been studying Lumpo Cha's teachings, you'll know he keeps saying it's uncertain. So to not try and create the future and to let go of expectations as much as possible. And then to set the intention to learn from everything. Like, if you go to the Wat and then you twist your ankle and you're and you're kind of, you got bandages on and you can't walk straight. No, this is really annoying. I've been looking forward to this and now I've got a twisted ankle. I can't walk properly. Well, now what can the twisted ankle teach me? This wasn't what I expected or what I planned. Now, this is my Ajahn. And so then, whether it's an injury like that, or whether it's that you, things that you expected would be a problem, or things that you find wonderfully inspiring, or things that you didn't expect would be a problem, whatever it might be, expected, unexpected, pleasant, painful, just to keep asking yourself, what can this teach me? What can I learn from this? Then you'll use the time very, very fruitfully. It'll be a great benefit to you. The challenge is always to remember that, because we are often getting lost in our own judgments. Like, well, this is good, that's bad. Oh, my meditation was really good last night. Like, well, okay, that was a meditation according to my wishes. Now, what does that teach me? And then another night, oh, my mind was all over the place. I was kind of confused and angry and lustful and restless and sleepy all at the same time. You know, okay, you can say, that wasn't what you call a good meditation, but what can I learn from that? You could say, no, it was a complete disaster. Well, you can call it that, but what did it teach you? What can you learn from that? Then, whether it's what you like or what you don't like, what you expect, what you don't expect, then everything will be a benefit to you. It's, I was speaking about the precepts as a way of spelling out what is our own heart's most kind of, our heart's deepest wishes, if you like. That is the five precepts for lay practice. It's important to see that's not like an imposition from outside, but really what our citta, our heart, really longs for: truth, unselfishness, clarity, peacefulness. It's a way of spelling that out. And the life of a monk is just the same. It's not, even though there's a lot more rules, still the life of the of a monk is trying to spell out the most sort of pure and simple way of living. So it's not like it's not helpful to see it as a whole set of things coming from outside that you've got to carry around, but rather it's a quality of your own heart that's expressing itself in the way you act. Does that make sense? When the Buddha was formulating the idea of the eight precepts, it was because he wanted to come up with a way for the lay community of, using the moon days, the one pra, in the most useful fashion. So he invented the idea of the eight precepts based on the mind of an arahant. He said, from the time of their enlightenment, all their lives, an arahant will never deliberately take the life of another creature. Now, wouldn't it be good for the lay community, for one day and one night a week, that they refrain, they also don't kill anything. In that way, they will be living as the arahants do, and that will be for their long-lasting welfare and happiness. So too with stealing, with sexual activity, with lying and the other precepts. He said, this is what the arahants do. And by taking on that behavior, then you are kind of listening to that voice in your heart that says, I don't want to hurt anything. I don't need to get that to be happy. I don't need to follow this sexual impulse. I don't need to have supper in the evening. I've had enough to eat. I don't need to have a fancy place to sleep. I'm okay. And so that it, rather than a set of limitations coming from outside, the life of a monk is like live just, if you were an arahant, that's how you would choose to live anyway. That's, and so that, if you like, is listening to the pure heart, the chit bodhisut, the chittam. And so if you see it in that way, then the life of a monk is then an expression of what you already are. And it's letting go of those the impulses of the reptile brain and learning to live as simply and as harmlessly, as nobly as possible.
One question that I confused and for a long time, when for the bunya, I mean, when I do something, I feel comfortable and I feel happy. That is bunya, that what I understand. Okay. So when I put the something on the bowl of the on the bowl in the morning, sidebar, to the monk, before I put in, I feel okay, I want to put the light for the monk, so the monk can have the light to eat, to surviving. Okay. And that make me happy to give something to the monk. And in the same way, if I give the water to the some people that I know on the street, that they feel thirsty, and I give some water to them, and I feel happy that I give it to them, that is the same bunya or not?
Well, the in the Buddha's teachings on this, he said that the different kinds of giving, giving with a pure heart. If your heart is pure, but the who you're giving to, the heart is not pure, that's one kind of giving. So like giving to say an animal, that's one kind of giving. Or that if your heart is not pure, but the heart of the other is pure, that's another kind of giving. Where your heart and their heart, neither of them is pure, that's another kind. And the fourth kind is where your heart is pure and the one who's receiving the offering is also pure. The Buddha said that's the best kind of giving, where the intention is pure and the mind of the one receiving is pure. But I feel it's not so helpful to, in terms of thinking of how much boon can I get, because the boon is not like a kind of bank account. Sometimes people relate to it like, okay, if you can get some rice in the bowl of an arahant, that's a big investment, big return. It's like a 75% return on your investment. Very powerful. But then if the attitude is, I want to get, it's for me, I get, that very atta, that feeling of I and me and mine, that kind of cuts off any real boon, because the boon is really the brightness of your own heart. So if you give a little bit of water to a dog on the street, and the dog is lapping up the water, and you feel, it's so thirsty, and the dog is so happy, your heart is really bright. It's not for you at all. So the dog is like a stray dog, you're giving it some water. At that time, you're not going, I want to get some merit. It's just because the dog is thirsty, you're helping the dog. So at that point, your heart is pure, and even though it's a dog, there's a great brightness in your heart. If you hear, Lungpu so and so is coming. I gotta go and see him. I gotta, get something in his bowl because, I'm really gonna score some points. It's all about atta. You're actually not even really paying attention to the monk. You're just paying attention to the reputation. You haven't even really opened the mind to that. It's just like, this one's got, there's a big return on this one. And it's all about atta. It's about me getting something, self-advantage. And so that I'd say it's much more boon giving the water to the dog than putting the bowl and the rice in the bowl, even if it is an arahant that you're putting rice in the bowl of, if the intention is for the self benefit, for me and mine, as Lungpho Puttata would say, tua ku, kong ku, then my sway. But the best, the most punya comes from wisdom. You know, in the Buddha's own description in the Velama Sutta, he said, you know, in a previous lifetime, I was a Brahmin in the city of Velama, and I made this enormous offering, 84,000 pots of silver filled with gold, 84,000 golden pots filled with silver, you know, 84,000 wagons and 10,000 horses, 10,000 elephants, you know, and I made that offering. He said, but even more punya than came from that enormous offering, like what would be billions and billions and billions of baht. He said, there's more punya in practicing metta bhavana, loving kindness, for the time that it takes to milk a cow. 20 minutes of metta bhavana is more punya than that big offering. And he said, but even more punya comes from having the insight into anicca, just for a finger snap. To truly see anicca, just wetio, for a finger snap. To truly see anicca, that's more punya than that offering of billions and billions and billions of baht. So the quality of punya is it's helpful to see what it is and how it works. It's really the brightness of your own heart, and that brightness is most complete the less that there is the I and me and mine. The more there's me trying to get something, then that light is very dim, or it's hidden by that. It's like having light in your pocket. Take the light out of the pocket, then you can see clearly. So I hope that helps your question.
Krab namaskar na krab. I have two questions, but I'd like to begin with the story of how I got this question. Through my life of Thai education for 18 years, I was taught that religion is a thing that teaches us to be a good person. Well, I bought it back then. But the more I grew up, I learned that you cannot be a good person in every religion, such as you cannot be a good person for Christian and still being a good person in other religions, meaning that you cannot take different gods at the same time. So I said to myself, I'll be atheist. And then one day, well, I met him, actually, and he said that Buddhism is not a religion. Actually, he said atheist is a part of Buddhism himself. Buddhism taught us not to believe and yet not to disbelieve. So my question are, what's really the definition of religion? And is atheist really a subset of Buddhism?
A good question. Well, it depends on which dictionary you use. I'm not kidding. Because you can define, if you use the Oxford English Dictionary, it defines religion as the belief in a creator God, in which case Buddhism is not a religion. If you use the, I think the Merriam-Webster religion, definition of religion in the Merriam-Webster dictionary, then it says a process of beliefs and practices that lead towards the emancipation of the individual. So that's definitely, Buddhism is definitely a religion then. So how the word is analyzed or defined. I would say that in the Merriam-Webster dictionary, that dictionary definition, that's quite accurate, that the Buddhadāsa, the Buddhist faith, is a system of practices and a system of knowledge and that is designed to help individuals to live in a way that is harmonious and to lead to their own fulfillment. That fulfillment manifesting as peacefulness of mind and a harmonious living amongst in society and in the world. So I'd say Buddhism is a religion in that respect, but it's not a religion that is based upon belief, because the Buddha specifically discourages that sense of believing, but rather testing things out. It's very much in accord with what we call the scientific method, that you have a working hypothesis. You have you try things out, and then it's a working hypothesis, meaning, okay, we'll take this to be true enough for the time being, but we're ready to update this when we find out other facts or we improve our knowledge. So that's very much in the spirit of Buddha Dhamma, and the point being that it's not about the words you use to describe things. It's like the vehicle that you drive. It's about where you want to get to, and it's that human potential that is present in all of us. I'd say the thing that attracted me towards Buddhism was because I was very skeptical and didn't want to believe anything, but it pointed out that, well, the words or the images, the symbolism of a belief, whether it's Hinduism or Islam or Christianity or communism or anarchism, you know, any kind of ism, that they are all just structures. How could a person who calls himself a Muslim or a Jew or an atheist be fundamentally different? The mind, the body, they work in exactly the same way. You can do a blood transfusion from a Muslim to an atheist. You know, Richard Dawkins could receive a blood transfusion from a Jehovah's Witness. He might not like the idea, but we're all built the same, in my understanding of things. So that in that respect, I'd say that Buddhism is a religion. The other part of your question was on.
Is atheism a part of Buddhism?
Say that again.
Is atheism a part of?
Is atheism? Of, yeah. Well, atheism, it means, the dictionary definition is that it's a belief that there is no God, there is no theos, there is no ultimate reality. So Buddhism is not atheistic, it's rather non-theistic, which means to say that it's not based on the idea of a creator God. It doesn't it doesn't dismiss the idea of theos, of gods. You've got lots of gods, you know, Brahma gods, devas, you know, many gods. It's a kind of multi-theistic religion, but the idea of the ultimate reality being some kind of super being, super entity, doesn't exist within Buddhism. And so it's it might seem that they're identical, to say atheistic and non-theistic, but that's a distinction that's made in the English language, so that it's you do have gods, but they're not the most important thing in Buddha Dhamma. So that, like Ajahn Buddhadāsa used to say, that the best translation for the English word God is Dhamma. So like the Gospel of John, according to Ajahn Buddhadasa's translation, is rather than in the beginning was the word, the logos, is in the beginning was the Dhamma. Interesting concept. So I see that the time is coming around. Do we have time for
Prajan? Most of what we've discussed tonight has been the world of ideas, and I just want to shift a little bit to get your comments about the role of meditation in the whole process of moving on the path. Thank you.
Well, meditation is the best way of understanding the nature of mind. So meditation, not just in terms of creating a singleness of focus on a particular object, But meditation in terms of watching how the mind works, how thoughts form and how they arise and pass away, feelings, moods, memories. So meditation is, say, studying how the mind is, what its habits are, learning how it's conditioned to, say, attach to certain things or push away certain things, learning what the potentials of the mind are and arousing the wholesome potentials and strengthening them, and seeing what are the obstructive or confusing qualities and learning to let go or not feed them. So meditation is the most powerful tool for understanding the nature of mind and for cultivating, you know, what is going to support the wholesome qualities, the guna dhamma, and what is going to help the unwholesome and obstructive qualities to be let go of. There are many different kinds of meditation, but they revolve around a couple of different qualities. One is the quality of peacefulness, focusing the mind in the present moment, and to counteract the habits of distraction, like following sounds and feelings and memories and ideas and mental images. So training the mind not to be distracted, or which literally means pulled apart, but to be focused on the present moment. So that's the first aspect of meditation. But then it also, the other aspect is the quality of, say, using the mind's ability to watch and to know, to see how experience works, to see how the mind experiences things, and through seeing how the mind formulates an experience, like this moment, so seeing how the mind puts together sound and light and feeling and creates BIA, you know, on a Saturday evening and says, here it is, this is it. How the mind forms this experience and names, oh, this is a Dhamma talk, you know, I'm a human being. These are people gathered together. It's now 7:20. You know, we put together this moment and how the mind creates the experienced reality, and what and then through that capacity to look and to know, seeing how that is that experience is formed, and then seeing how it arises, how it passes away, and then through that, say, studying of the process of experience, learning how to not get entangled and identified with the body, with the personality, with like and dislike, attraction and aversion. So what we call insight, vipassana, is that quality of understanding and knowing the nature of experience, how the mind creates experiences, and through that, seeing and knowing how the mind formulates the world moment by moment, then it can disentangle. The quality of awareness can, be trained to not identify with the body, with the personality, with inside, outside, like and dislike, and can, through that disentangling, awaken to its own timeless, infinite, non-personal nature. So, in short, meditation is the best set of tools that you've got available. There are many, many different techniques that can be used to support concentration. Different objects, different forms. I'd say they need to involve both the body and the mind to help things be balanced. There are various different ways to help develop insight, but as long as those two aspects are present, of calming and focusing the mind and then looking into the nature of experience, then that meditation will result in that helping us to get where we want to go.